It's my pleasure to welcome our opening grand keynote speaker, one of the most visionary leaders in Silicon Valley, President and CEO of Adobe, Shantanu Narayen, on the stage. Under Shantanu's leadership, Adobe has successfully undergone an industry-leading business transformation, moving its highly successful creative software business to the cloud, and creating and leading the digital marketing category. As a result of his strategic vision and relentless pursuit of innovation, Adobe has achieved record revenues and renowned recognition as a bold leader in the software industry. Shantanu's story began like many of us here in the room. He grew up in Hyderabad, India, where he studied engineering. He came to America to pursue his master's degree and moved to Silicon Valley after graduation to begin his career in technology. He held many successful product leadership positions at different companies here in the Valley, even pursuing a stint as a successful entrepreneur when he co-founded Pictra, an early pioneer of digital photo sharing over the internet. He joined Adobe in 1998, swiftly rising through the ranks and eventually becoming CEO in 2007. Today, Shantanu will start by sharing his perspective on the industry landscape and the mandate for companies to focus on customer experiences to stay ahead. Following his presentation, Shantanu will be joined on stage for a conversation with managing editor of CNBC TV18 from India, Shireen Bhan. Shireen has over 15 years of experience in the field of television broadcast, tracking companies and events that define the business landscape in India and rest of the world. She's also the anchor and editor of Young Turks, one of the longest running shows on entrepreneurs in India. We are thrilled that she has joined us from India to not only host this conversation, but to also cover TiEcon and report on the great content here for the audiences back home. So with that, let's get started. Please join me in extending a warm welcome to one of my good friends, Shantanu Narayen.
Don't want to live as an untold story, rather go out in a blaze of glory. I can't hear you, I don't fear you. I'll live now cause the bad die last, dodging bullets with your broken past. I can't hear you, I don't fear you now. Wrapped in your regret, what a waste of blood and sweat. Oh, I wanna taste love and pain, wanna feel pride and shame. I don't wanna take my time, don't wanna waste one life. I wanna live better days, never look back and say, could have been me, it could have been me. Yeah, I wanna taste love.
Ladies and gentlemen, Shantanu Narayen.
Thank you, Venk. Thank you and good morning. It's absolutely great to be here again at TiEcon. It's actually been 15 years since I was last here on a panel, and just to see the amazing growth and the amount of entrepreneurship and innovation that TiE has spurred is really inspiring. I think it goes without saying that it's an absolutely phenomenal time in the Valley to be a technology entrepreneur. Nearly $60 billion in venture investments were poured into startups last year, only second, I think, to 2000, which was the dot-com boom. And despite records that are being set in the amount of investments and reports that talk about the end of the unicorn era, I think there's more exciting innovation that's happening in Silicon Valley today and in the tech community than ever before. In my 30 years here in the Valley, as an engineering leader, as an entrepreneur, as Venk mentioned, and as a business exec, I have never been more energized by the possibilities that exist today. And whether it's from silicon to software, from consumer services to enterprise platforms, technology is enabling people to innovate and change and touch people's lives in big and small ways. Think about it, a giant media company decides to make an unknown superhero as big as Captain America without any ad spend whatsoever. Deadpool, which was an unknown foul-mouthed anti-hero, was introduced to us through an innovative social media campaign, making us laugh and groan with completely irreverent images and videos and a clever public service announcement. And the result? It was the highest grossing R-rated film in history and is quickly becoming a franchise. Think about how we are impacted. Working parents who dream of an unattainable theme park vacation for their kids. But today, with excess inventory and the right deal and message that can reach them, and just with a few clicks and swipes, they can afford a vacation that previously they might only have dreamed of. A digital experience that brought them to a magical place in the real world, and an experience that they will never forget. Or think about how you may be in the market for new clothes, no hangers, no changing rooms, with what's happening with augmented reality and virtual reality. Everything that you can see can be turned into clickable, buyable items, all in the comfort of your home. And the end result? You look fabulous, thanks to digital experiences that are today merging the online world with the real world. I also think about how digital experiences are touching my own life. My elder son turned 25, and he wanted to celebrate by going and watching Kobe Bryant once at Staples Center before he retired. And my younger son also came to the event from Brown. Everything that was done, the hotel reservations, the airline reservations, buying the tickets, everything was done with a few clicks on a tablet, the rental car, reservations. All of this was being done actually while I was catching up with the latest episodes of House of Cards. This is life today. It's life today that's been made better and different through digital experiences. But that's only relevant when it's done right. Because these experiences today are designed to blow our minds and to go completely unnoticed actually, because then they seamlessly blend into our daily existence. And so all powerful digital experiences today must be personal, must be predictive, and they must work flawlessly and brilliantly. In all my meetings with CEOs, with business and government leaders all around the world, it is completely clear that there's one theme that's top of minds to everybody, and that's digital disruption. Because we all know that consumer expectations and technology advances are causing every single organization in the world to rethink their digital strategies. And maintaining the status quo of any business today is just not an option. And so we're starting to see every industry and every business look to differentiate themselves through the digital experience that they provide. For example, brands are creating online experiences to connect directly with consumers, from store within a store concepts to the rich e-commerce applications that we all use. Retailers are using brand new terms like entertaining and shoppertainment in order to capture and maintain that consumer attention that they need to. Shopping has become a competitive sport. Think about TV networks that are going straight to consumers, and the media industry is being disrupted, creating a standalone TV everywhere experience, untethered to the cable provider. And cable providers themselves, in turn, are now expanding their on-demand services and getting into original content. And we all know that TV viewing will never be the same again. And even in the public sector, when you think about what citizen engagement is doing, it is changing how people expect to interact with government all around the world. And all of this is so easy to imagine, but it's so much harder to do. And as history has shown, when there are new consumer expectations and when there's technology advances, to somebody who's innovative, all of this represents a huge opportunity. It represents a huge opportunity for those in business to consumer, and it also represents a huge opportunity for those in business to business. And what I thought today I would do is focus on what I see as opportunities in the enterprise software market. I think the first wave of enterprise disruption, the back office wave, began in the early days of computing and networking. Businesses all around the world began investing in MRP and ERP systems to automate the back end. And the improvement in time and financial controls gave all the early adopters in that market a huge competitive advantage. And every boardroom had the conversation around how they could use ERP to differentiate themselves. That was a market that was $30 billion, and it was considered a bold move. But we all know that today the back office is table stakes in today's industry. We then had the front office wave and the introduction of Salesforce automation as well as CRM. A closely guarded Rolodex and a phone used to be the most powerful tools that the salesperson had, and when they walked, the entire contact list walked out with them. But what the front office did was it empowered companies to manage that customer information and to create control over their sales processes and to create a direct relationship with their customers. And the CRM market is also a $30 billion opportunity. But like the back office, I think the front office has also become table stakes. And no head of sales, no company today that's operating would operate without it. We believe that we're at the beginning of a third wave of enterprise transformation, and we call that the experience business wave. And unlike the two other waves that happened that were more internally focused within an enterprise, we think that the enterprise business wave is focused more on a company's, it's not focused on a company's operations and products. It's focused on meeting these ever-increasing customer demands. Because consumers expect brand new things from businesses, whether it's the local yogurt shop, whether it's multinational operations, to give them that experience that they want, when they want, and how they want it. And they expect every single touch point or interaction with a company to be consistent, to be continuous, and to be compelling. Not to mention it to be personalized and secure, which adds up to this amazing digital experience and journey that a business can provide. And we think that the experience business wave is the new competitive battleground. We think it represents a tectonic shift that will cause every business to transform in ways that they haven't had to for decades, from how they market, from how they sell, from how they create products. And new roles are being created, new roles like chief digital officer, chief experience officer. And all of the technology trends that we talk about, from mobile to cloud to social to big data to learning, is going to come together to create a massive opportunity for people who are entrepreneurial and want to take advantage of this. And I think it's a massive opportunity for the Thai community to drive how this unfolds, not just here in the US, but all around the world. We think these experiences always start with great content. Beautiful design, aesthetics, and eye-catching imagery have always had the power to move, to educate, to incite people, and to create that emotional connection with a business. And going digital in the old days used to be as simple as creating a website. And then there was the explosion of screens. You had phones and tablets and watches, along with more video and applications. But today, these digital experiences have to be integrated with all the physical experiences. And this technology of content creation and experience is more important than ever before, and the content velocity that you need to create is greater than ever before. Because getting that right content to the right person at the right place, it takes data. It takes insights and intelligence, which are the engine of these highly personalized and customized experiences. The truth is, robots will never do great marketing, and human intuition can never be replaced. But if you can harness the power of computing, man plus machine, to make these things work faster and smarter, I think we as a community can make great things happen. At Adobe, this is a little bit about what we do. We create the technology that brings these compelling, immersive digital experiences into being. The experiences that need to be formed by insights, supported by data, and brought to life by beautiful, powerful creations. We have the Creative Cloud, which is a one-stop shop for inspiration for creative professionals all the way out to monetization. And that's the transformation that we've been through to be able to innovate at a faster pace and provide great value to our customers on an ongoing basis. The Adobe Document Cloud, which is all about enabling people to automate business processes, including signatures, and to transform them into 100% digital workflows. And the Marketing Cloud, which is a complete set of marketing solutions to give you deep analytics, processing power, and data science to deliver these personalized experiences in real time. And together, they form the Adobe Cloud Platform that enables people to create, manage, measure, monetize, and mobilize all of their digital content. I think as tech entrepreneurs and leaders of established businesses, all of us in this room have a unique take on how technology defines our businesses and strategy. Each of us, if we are living in this experience business, need to be asking ourselves a set of questions. Is there a unique opportunity for us as a company to compete in this experience era? Is my organization aligned and structured to put the customer at the center of everything that we're doing? And what role does technology platform play in enabling not just me, but my entire organization to make this happen? And we think that the power and impact on people should not be underestimated. I think with digital experiences today, we can entertain the masses and steal the box office. We can change a family's life with their dream vacation. We can revolutionize retail and the buying experience completely, and so much more. It's our mission to help continue to change the world through these digital experiences, and as a community, we hope you will join us in this journey. And now I'm really pleased to welcome one of the most respected journalists in India, who's really a champion of innovation. Please join me in welcoming Shireen Bhan, who's managing editor of CNBC, to the stage for a conversation. Thank you.
Hi, Shantanu. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everybody, and thank you very much for having me here and giving me the opportunity to chat with Shantanu again. We do an annual interview, and I think we've been doing that for the last couple of years every time he visits India, which is, of course, a big area of opportunity for Adobe. Thank you very much for taking us through the opportunities that you foresee for the future. But if I could take you back in time, Shantanu, because all of this, you make it sound very easy, and transformations are very, very hard to pull off. So if I could take you back to about 2008 and 2009, when you actually saw a very sharp decline in revenues, and you were forced to make some tough choices about the road ahead. You were forced to make tough choices about how you intended to transform Adobe. You also talked in a previous interview about dealing with antibodies within the system that oppose you when you're trying to force change. If you can share with the audience what that experience was like going through that phase of trying to transform the company, because post that, you actually haven't had any bumps. You've actually been on an up curve.
Well, maybe I was trying to block those memories out, Shireen, but...
I won't let you.
Well, I think you're right. In 2008, we saw that our revenues were declining and we weren't attracting as many new customers to the platform. And we saw that the volume of data that was being created was still exploding, right? The amount of websites, mobile applications, and our recurring revenue in 2008 was about 5% of our business. And that's when we decided to embark on reimagining the creative process, which is how do we think about a new way of defining content and enabling people to create content wherever inspiration strikes.
Sure.
And as you point out, we actually had to reduce our revenue by $1 billion because instead of recognizing the revenue up front, we were recognizing it ratably. And our EPS actually declined by 65% the first year that we were doing it. And you know, change is hard. Change is hard in organizations. And there were many people, because the customer reaction initially was not as positive because people still hadn't seen all of the benefits of moving to the cloud. So you're right. I used to talk about, while we wanted to make this change, the antibodies in the company came out and told us why. And I think this is true of all large organizations, why things cannot be done, as opposed to how they would benefit from doing it. But at the same time, I think it represented a unique opportunity for young champions. You have this great show called Young Turks. We had to find our own Young Turks who were willing to say, we're going to champion this new way of innovating and this new way of creating content. And you know, they found that their careers grew leaps and bounds. And you know, you try and bring everybody along for the journey, and a lot of people made that transition after it became obvious. But you know, you like to say that if your business strategy is trying to connect all the dots, it's probably not aspirational enough. And so we had this leap of faith. We believed that we could deliver a better value to our customers. But the internal evangelism and selling of that idea was perhaps harder than even the external presence, to your point.
I get that. And I want to just extend on this point a little further, because I think this is something or a dilemma that a lot of people in this audience would also perhaps be grappling with. You know, it's easy to talk about resetting expectations, but it's difficult to actually be able to pull that off. And at the same time, to be able to align the organization to those expectations and communicate that effectively. Take us through the insights in your experience and your journey of being able to do that successfully, efficiently.
Well, I think the first thing we did, honestly, Shireen, was we started with the customer. And we said, can we deliver a better value to our customers? I remember there was a meeting with the Photoshop team. They had you know, planned on a new version of the product. There was a phenomenal new camera that was coming out a month later. And they were all sitting moping in the room. And I went there and they said, we're trying to support this new camera that's coming out a month later than when the product's released. And you know, I fancied myself as an engineer, so I said, let me roll up my sleeves and help you.
You still roll up your sleeves, by the way?
I tried. And they're like, hey, the engineering stuff is trivial. We could do that in our sleep. What we didn't know how to do was deal with revenue recognition. And so we found ourselves that we had created a place where our business model was predicated on how can we put more and more and more features every 12 or 18 months, as opposed to bite-sized chunks of innovation and continuous innovation. And you know, I think that was a turning point where we recognized that the world had moved. And if we continued to stay on our old journey of, you know, traditional 12 or 18 month product cycles, complete secrecy about what we are working on, we were gonna be antiquated pretty soon. So started with the customer journey. Then you, to your point, you have to paint a vision of what it is. And you know, you take a little bit of a leap of faith. But we had pilots that we ran in Australia where we brought out this new business model and the new software. And I think we learned a lot from it. The truth is, every customer is willing to give you their insight if you're willing to listen.
Yeah.
And I think that was another lesson for us. And so we learned about what was going right and what was not going right. But the two things that I underestimated was the amount of internal evangelism that we had to continuously do in order to get people to adopt to it. You know, we're on the 18th floor of our building in San Jose, and you know, I say maybe there's low oxygen on that floor, and you know, we all thought that we got it, but you have to go out and continuously, you know, tell people and you know, over communicate. And I think the importance of over communication was something that I'd forgotten, because as a management team, you all say, okay, we got to go. And then you just assume that everybody is on board and aligned with it. And I think that took a while. And then I would say the one other area where we did a really good job was communication with the financial investors as to, you know, how this would roll out. And we were fortunate, because I think in a lot of times when you're going through a big transition, people dump your stock and then they see, you know, whether you make the transition. And I think painting that vision of why this was a better, you know, for customers, for employees to innovate, as well as for all our stakeholders, I think that was good. And, you know, I think the good news is it worked out, which is why I'm here. Otherwise, my successor would be here telling you what a brain dead idea that was.
Well, and I'm happy that you're here and we're having this conversation, Shantanu. But you know, the reason I wanted to talk about the past was because it's always imperative to understand or get insights from the past when you're trying to attack the future. Now let me talk to you about the future, because you've just painted for us or articulated your vision as far as, if I could loosely call it that, taking on the experience economy. In terms of disrupting yourself at this point in time, in order for you to be able to leverage that addressable market and that addressable opportunity, what are the levers that you're going to have to exercise, and what will you need to change within the organization now to be able to be experience economy ready?
It's a good question, and it's one that if you had a recipe, you know, I guess we'd all replicate it more, Shireen, than we can. I mean, I think, you know, when you look at a company our size, let's say, you know, about 5.8 billion this year, 45, 50 billion in market cap. The truth is, what moves the needle, you know, right off the bat, if you believe that the expectations of that should be too high, I think you can then fall into this trap of not investing in new innovation and disrupting yourself. And I think, you know, what we try and do is we identify areas that are going to be strategic. To give you a couple examples, we talk about video.
Yeah.
We think video is going to get completely transformed. It's going to move from TV and media distribution to IP networks. So we say, have we identified a large area? And are we going to ruthlessly focus on trying to understand how that's going to get disrupted? Another one might be signatures. I mean, it's crazy in this day and age that we think a physical signature is any more legitimate than an electronic signature. So, you know, we try and identify themes where it's going to be big, and then we try and get sponsors. Because again, going back to that antibody conversation, unless you get sponsorship within a company for some of these key initiatives, I think, you know, they tend to actually have more people telling you why it doesn't work. And so I think when we think about disruption, we try and, if you can't describe your strategy in a few words, you know, if you need 20 PowerPoint or PDF slides, it's probably too complicated, right?
Yeah.
And so we try and say, do we have a core hypothesis of what we're trying to do, and find a champion? And then we, you know, we bring Silicon Valley, Sand Hill Road to Adobe, and we say, let's, you know, fund them. Let's not have them go through the normal budgeting process. And that's the way we do it. And last but certainly not least, I think we try and celebrate failure as well. I mean, what makes the value so unbelievably unique is that there's no stigma associated with trying something and failing. And I think all large companies, if you send the message that somebody who's sticking their neck out and failing in that, that they are done, you will never have innovation in a company again. And so, you know, those are a couple of, I think, things that we have tried. Every business starts at a $0 billion business. I don't know a single business that started at, you know, greater than a $0 billion business. And so if you believe that, that's how hopefully you spur innovation.
So if I can pick up on the point that you just made, what are the key hypotheses that you're working on today or you're betting on today that you hope will deliver for you in the future?
Well, we're betting that, you know, we bet on data. We bet on content and data. And we said, you know, if you cannot use data to deliver the great experience, I mean, way too often you probably go to a website, you buy something, and then because of retargeting, you're getting that ad follow you around for the next 3 weeks, and you're probably saying, hey, wait a minute, I just bought that. So how we can take this digital, you know, treasure of data that exists and in a personal and a, you know, with consciousness of privacy, deliver you the experience. So we're just believing that digital is going to transform every industry, and using content and data are our core hypotheses. If we can help people deliver that right experience, we think that's going to be a big opportunity. Apart from education, every industry has been transformed. Financial services, tech, retail and hospitality, automotive. And so we just think it's the biggest opportunity that's existed. And you know, the beautiful thing for people in this audience is somebody with a great idea and you know, intellectual property can actually go after it.
So I want to touch upon the issue of differentiation, because this is not an opportunity that you alone are going after. There's a bunch of guys within the startup ecosystem, and of course the big boys like Googles of the world who are going after the exactly same opportunity. If I were to ask you about the key differentiators that you will exercise, what would those be? Because that's going to be imperative to see where you end up in the market share game as well.
Well, I think our key differentiator was our affinity with the people who are creating all of that content. That's why we talk about content and data. We've always had a great relationship with the chief marketing officer or the people who are pulling together that. And if you believe that design and aesthetics are important, given the role that Adobe plays at the front end of that value chain of content, that hopefully will be our continued differentiation. But you're only as good as the innovation that you provided, you know, and how you get that sense of urgency, you know, is important.
Well, speaking of innovation and urgency, Shantanu, I think you've done, what, about since 2009, 20-odd acquisitions at Adobe, a total of about 45, if my memory serves me correctly. How much of the innovation play is going to be inorganic? How much of it is going to be you looking out there in the market, picking up niche companies that you believe can add value?
Well, we're in the digital marketing business as a result of an inorganic acquisition that we did, correct? Omniture. But you're right. I think every company that's large has to realize that inorganic acquisition and organic innovation is the secret. We look for three things. We look for great technology, we look for great people, and we look for a shared vision.
And how do you make it work? Because integration is often hard and tough to do.
There's somebody on my staff or me who has to say we are the sponsor of any acquisition, because otherwise it's too hard. It's too hard. And so I want to understand who on my staff is willing to bet their mortgage and say we're going to carry that on our backs, because it does require that.
There's a room full of entrepreneurs here. You know, what are you going to go out shopping for next? What would be on the radar?
I'm not sure I want to raise valuations right now. That may be the one thing that's already a little out of control.
Well, do you believe valuations are frothy today?
I think valuations are a little frothy, and I think you're seeing that. In the SaaS-based business, it was all about growth at any cost, and I think what you're correctly seeing right now is people want to see the growth, but they also want to see that there's potential for margin expansion, correct? But, you know, what we're looking for is, in the larger scheme of things, people who are in digital marketing, it's going to be a massive opportunity. I think there are a lot of companies that are focused on niche parts of that. Mm-hmm. And if we can deliver the platform, that's certainly an area that we're very interested in. And on the content side as well, you know, I mean, with AR and VR and all the benefits of what that will do for experiences, I think that's an area ripe for innovation.
Is there a war chest that you're willing to deploy in FY17?
We're always willing to deploy a war chest for the right product. And we're as cheap as we can be if it isn't the right product. So, you know, we're at both ends of the spectrum. I mean, in all reality, you say you can never pay too much for an acquisition that works well. Mm-hmm. And if an acquisition works badly, whatever you paid, you overpaid, right?
Yeah, that's right. Let me ask you this, Shantanu, because, you know, we live in an integrated economy at this point in time, and what happens in India or what happens in the U.S. impacts India, what happens in China impacts pretty much everybody in the world today. As you look out to your dashboard, what would be the key concerns, both on the macros as well as outside of that?
What's interesting is, you know, 5 years ago, Adobe would have said our biggest growth opportunity was emerging markets, because we had, as I mentioned, seen sort of saturation of the desktop software when we were perpetual or licensing. Through this transition, we actually focused a lot on developed markets, because developed markets was where the opportunity to transition people was much larger. As I look at emerging markets, there's some great opportunities for us. I think this is a well-known fact, but mobile, and how a mobile-only rather than a mobile-first environment, what does that do to industries and how does that disrupt industries? The second thing I look at is certainly the cost of transactions. When you look at what India has done with respect to financial transactions or delivery of goods, you know, the ability to innovate at an unbelievable pace. And in terms of markets itself, we think they'll be probably a little slower to develop in terms of overall size and TAMs, but these learnings could be invaluable. We can differentially price for the first time ever because we deliver our products through the cloud. When we delivered it in boxes, people could repackage it, have a gray market, and sell it back on eBay here in the US. We've completely eliminated that, you know. And so emerging markets, I think, continues to be a huge opportunity. I think you have to tailor your products and pricing for that market, but you learn a lot that I think then carries a lot of weight back in developed markets. But in general, we look at this move towards digital, and we think there's so much headroom there. even if there are bumps in the economy, we think long-term this continues to be a big opportunity.
So you're talking about the headrooms to growth, but if I were to ask you about the challenges or the bumps on the road that you see, particularly as far as the economic environment is concerned today, spending, what would you say would be the key risks for you?
Well, I think digital disruption is front and center. You know, I think there isn't a company that is not willing to take our call in order to do that. I'm no economist, but I think the political climate in all countries is going to be interesting to see, what happens and how that impacts, business confidence. Because as you know,
business... House of Cards is actually playing out, isn't it?
I don't know which is, truth and which is fiction right now. But I think in terms of business sentiment, certainly, stable governments and economic stability is a big part to government. But, Adobe's, we're 30 years plus old. I think in the tech business, that's fairly mature. But we think we invest for the next decade. Mm. And so, you're going to see bumps. You can't focus a company on worrying about bumps. You have to, I think, have a longer range viewpoint.
I want to quote you back to you. I remember you saying that the lens that you use to look at your opportunities will determine how aspirational you will be or how ambitious you are. What's the lens that you're using to look at the opportunities that you foresee today?
Well, I think, when Adobe started, we created desktop publishing. And I think we felt our lens was, people in imaging or editing. We expanded that to say it's all graphics professionals. Then we expanded that to say it's everybody who's trying to create and deliver documents through sharing. And so I look at it and now say the lens by which we look at it is anybody trying to create a digital experience, we should play some role in some part of that value chain, whether it's enabling people to create that, again, as I said, to manage it, to monetize it. We're in the content monetization game. Mm. We bought this company called Fotolia that does stock images. And we are like, why aren't we creating a community for our creative professionals to buy and sell stock asset? Mm. So I think if you continue to expand the way in which you look at it, that's when I do believe that you are aspirational.
This monetization challenge is a challenge that a lot of people are grappling with as we move towards this digital transformation. What would your insights really be on being able to address that issue?
I think for monetization, reduction of friction is the biggest issue that happens. I think if you look at what all of these great companies in e-commerce and retail have done is they've dramatically reduced the friction associated with, visitor acquisition and conversion. And so I think with monetization as well, at the end of the day, it's a marketplace. So if we can bring the supply and the demand and reduce the friction, in this case, for people to upload their assets and for people to integrate that into their content creation, I think that's the opportunity for Adobe specifically in monetization. But if you're in the monetization business, are you bringing together, supply and demand in a way in which is unique and differentiated? Mm.
You've been in this business now for about 30 odd years, Shantanu. As you look at the environment today and as you look at what's happening within the tech business, product life cycles are shrinking, the disruption that we're seeing. What excites you the most about what you see today? Beyond, of course, the experience economy that we've just talked about. As an engineer, what excites you the most?
I think the use of data in healthcare is one of those areas that excites me tremendously. I'm fortunate to serve on the board of Pfizer. And if we now think about how healthcare and personalized medicine can completely get transformed by access to data, I think that's going to change how people look at technology in a very different way. So it's across each industry, but if there's one that I would identify, it's the ability to make an impact in people's lives by using data in healthcare.
You're not particularly worried about the slowdown that we're seeing in the startup ecosystem. I mean, people are talking about that in India. There's concerns about funding drying up. There is a slowdown here in the US as well, but you don't believe that the unicorns are going anywhere. In fact, you believe that there are huge opportunities there. But what would the advice be to young entrepreneurs who are really addressing the issues of scale and scaling up quickly as well? Because that seems to be one of the factors that could end up hurting a company if you don't actually do that efficiently. What would your advice be as they scale up?
Well, two things. First is I think there's always access to capital for great ideas. You have to believe that as an entrepreneur. And the second thing is be unreasonable with your expectations of yourself. Mm. If you're unreasonable, great things happen. if you believe in just what's possible today, you're never going to innovate.
Okay, that's easy, but it to try and convince investors at a time when liquidity is not easy to come by, what more would they need to do in terms of hard selling the story?
Well, I think the beauty about TiEcon is you have both the people who are funding and the people who are looking for funding. You just have to believe. You have to believe. I mean, great things. I think it was Bernard Shaw or somebody who said, real change happened by people who were willing to question the status quo. So question the status quo.
As a CEO, you've been questioning the status quo at Adobe. Before we, I think we're almost up on time, so my final question to you. As you look at what you've been able to achieve at Adobe and what you hope to achieve at Adobe going forward, what would that one aspiration be? You said you don't believe in 40 PowerPoint presentation slides to explain your vision or your philosophy. If I were to ask you to end, what would that one mission or vision statement be for you on where you see Adobe in the future?
I get motivated by impact. And I think if Adobe can continue to have an impact on how, the world deals with digital, I think we would have done our job.
Shantanu, it's been an absolute pleasure speaking with you. Thank you very much for your time. And ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for listening.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot.
Pleasure. Thank you so much.